Yeah. I think it's great.
Okay. Morning, everyone. We're in for a treat today. My friend Mario Delmar will be speaking. Mario and I have known each other for many years now. We met in the early 1990s and have maintained a friendship and sometimes a rivalry since then. Well, not really a rivalry.
No, we just have the same brain.
Yeah, but you know, he has made many discoveries that are pivotal to a number of people in this room. For example, he was the first to describe with Steve Taffet, the small 20 kilodalton isoform that came to be so important in Jamie's work. He is interested in the sodium channel and the relationship to connexins, which is, you know, work that Steve and I and Cy are very interested in. And now he is working on mesenchymal cells and how they relate to fibrotic disease in the heart, which is an area which is near and dear to John Chappell's work, for example, on pericytes. So, you know, a remarkable career, many achievements. Mario trained in Mexico, but very early on came up to the United States to work with Pepe Jalife, rose through the ranks there to full professor before moving on to NYU to join Glenn Fishman and the various luminaries in the department in New York City, and has continued to do sort of outstanding and paradigm-breaking work. So I know Mario's a very good speaker. I'm not going to go on much further. I'm going to let him take over, but I'm sure we're going to have an interesting and fun time as we listen to the information that he tells us.
Thank you, Rob. Thank you very much, and thanks for the introduction. As Doug Zipes always says, my parents would be proud. My high school friends wouldn't believe you. The purpose of my presentation today is to tell you a story that we have developed on the mechanisms of a disease called arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. And I will try to go between disease and basic science and hopefully keep all of the information together. We may want those down. Ah, okay. So anyway, thank you very much for having me. It is really a pleasure to be here. I will start by telling you the people that actually did the job while I go around, see good old friends, and have pleasant dinners. They are in the lab doing all of the work that I will tell you about. It has been, for this particular project, really a collaboration between many people in my laboratory. I will show data that at one point or another has involved all of the people listed here, as well as collaborations with many colleagues in various universities. And of course, I have not listed the names of those that under a particular PI have been working on this project, but they all have been instrumental in this. So the story begins here. This is the heart of a 16-year-old boy who seems perfectly healthy, is playing soccer with his friends, and all of a sudden collapses, has a cardiac arrest, cannot be resuscitated, and is declared dead on arrival at the hospital. This boy did not have any health problems, but when they study his heart, they realize that the heart, instead of having a muscular structure on the free wall of the right ventricle, the muscle has been replaced by this fibroid and adipose tissue that you can see here in the histology. The muscle should look like this. The entire wall should look like that, but instead, starting from the epicardium, actually, you can see that the heart has been replaced by fibrous and adipose tissue on the right ventricular wall predominantly, although there is some collagen also in the left side. Without any symptoms, this boy has fallen, however, not into a problem of the mechanical aspect of his heart, but on a problem of the electrical aspect of his heart, develops a sudden arrhythmia and dies. This boy is diagnosed with a disease called arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. Those of you familiar with the field may know that the name has several variations. Most common, arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia. And nowadays, some people prefer the term arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy. Call it whatever you want. It is an inherited heart muscle disease that may result in arrhythmias, heart failure, and sudden cardiac death. But the problem that has interested us is, how is it that this disease is leading to arrhythmias, and particularly is leading to arrhythmias in the early stages of the disease? And as we wrote in this review article some years ago, it is the early phase, or the concealed phase of the disease, like in the case of that boy that I just showed you, that is characterized by a high propensity to ventricular arrhythmias and sudden cardiac death, and yet there is well-preserved morphology, histology, and ventricular function. So there is something about this disease that electrically predisposes the heart to very severe arrhythmias. Work that happened a number of years ago by now led to the conclusion that arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy is linked to mutations in desmosomal proteins. And an estimated 50 or 70% of the cases of familial arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy are linked to mutations in the particular gene coding for plakophilin 2. So the desmosomes are structures that are localized at the cardiac intercalated disc. So if you look at an EM section of heart tissue, you will see that where one cell, this is one cell here, these are the fibers, this is the Z disc, and this is the point at which the two cells are making contact with each other. So at this point of contact, there is an electrodense structure that is called the intercalated disc. If you look at a higher magnification at that intercalated disc structure, you will find several different structures. Some of them are involved in adhering one cell to one another. These are called adherence junctions, like this one. Some of them are there for electrical coupling, and these are the gap junctions. And there is also this structure called the desmosomes. So you can see here is the membrane of one cell. Here is the membrane of the other cell. They come very, very close together. It looks as though the membranes have fused in there. They are not fused. There is a gap between the two, and junctions traversing the gap. And that is why they were named by Jean-Paul Ravel many years ago, gap junctions. Now, in here, you can see that there is this sort of dense material. This is where the cells are mechanically coupling to each other. Cadherins are sticking into the intercellular space, and they are holding on to each other in the intercellular space. Inside the cell, they are connected to actin fibers. So when the actin fibers develop the force, that force can be transmitted between one cell and the other, and the heart can effectively pump. Desmosomes are also mechanical junctions, but in a different way. They are connected to intermediate filaments. So there are also cadherin-like molecules that are sticking into the intercellular space and holding on to each other. But inside, those cadherins are linked to the intermediate filaments. The best example to understand the function of desmosomes is the skin. The skin, the cells in the skin have a lot of desmosomes. If I stretch my skin, if I pull my skin and I stretch it, the cells don't rip away from each other. They all move together, and they move together because they have desmosomes that are holding one cell to the other. And then the skin goes back to its original place because the desmosome is attached to keratin, to an intermediate filament. So keratin is a very stretchable filament, and when you pull it, it will give. When you release it, it will come back to its position. The heart does not have keratin, but it has desmin, which is also an intermediate filament. The heart is a very flexible organ. We tend to think of the heart as a very strong muscle, and indeed it is. It's a very flexible organ. It has to expand and contract, and then expand back to its original position over and over again throughout our lives. The molecule that I will be talking about, plakophilin 2, is a component of the desmosome. Arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy is linked to mutations in the desmosome, but it is a mechanical junction. So this is the question that we started with. How is it that desmosomes, that are supposed to just making Velcro between cells are so involved in the electrical behavior of the heart that a mutation in a desmosomal molecule is giving us a high propensity to sudden death. So we decided to take the question from the other end, and that is to say, well, indeed Plakophilin-2 is a desmosomal molecule, but what if it does things other than making a desmosome? In other words, what if there are non-canonical functions to Plakophilin-2? And I always give the example that in molecular cardiology, as in many other fields, we have made the same mistake that endocrinologists did during the 19th and 20th century, and that is to name things after the very first thing they found them to do. So growth hormone is certainly very important for growth. But I need growth hormone now. I have no hopes of getting any taller. Prolactin, I need prolactin, but not for the function for which it was named. The same token, molecules, particularly in the intercalated disc, are recognized as belonging to a particular function, but it doesn't make sense that it is the only function that they do. And connexin being a perfect example, indeed it's important to make gap junctions, but it does things that have nothing to do with gap junctions. We took that approach to Plakophilin. It is a component of desmosome, but does it do anything other than making desmosomes? Well, being that we were interested in an electrical event, we decided to look in a system that does not involve desmosomes, and that is an isolated cardiac myocyte. So I am going to take single isolated cardiac myocytes, and I am going to remove Plakophilin-2 by using siRNA. And then I am going to look at the electrical behavior of that cell. If the electrical behavior is disrupted, it can't be because we lost desmosomes, because we already lost them. It is an isolated cell. So it's got to be something else that Plakophilin-2 does. So this is just to illustrate. We looked particularly at the protein that makes the sodium current in the heart. For those of you not knowledgeable on cardiac electrophysiology, the electrical event of the heart precedes the mechanical event, and that electrical event passes between one cell and the other in a relay system that involves sodium channels that allow a flush of sodium into the cell, that excite the cell, and then the passage of that electrical charge through gap junctions onto the next cell. That passage will excite the next cell so that there is a sodium influx in that cell that will then generate charge for the next cell. So this relay mechanism is used by the heart constantly to maintain electrical activity, the sodium channel being the most important component in the excitation of the heart cell. So the sodium channels tend to localize preferentially, but not exclusively, to the cell end where the intercalated disc would be if there was another cell here. And so does Plakophilin-2, the desmosomal molecule. So we decided to look at what happens to the sodium current if we remove Plakophilin-2. And what happens is, well, we did it by siRNA, and you can see that we did lose Plakophilin-2. And what happened is that the sodium current gets significantly reduced if we remove Plakophilin-2. So we take supposedly a desmosomal molecule, we take it away from a single cell, we look at the sodium current, and we find that don't worry about other panels, just see that the blue is the amount of sodium current that a cell can generate if there is no Plakophilin-2, and the red is the amount that it can generate if it does have Plakophilin-2. And without being an electrophysiologist, you just became one, because we look at these types of plots all the time. And this basically just says that there has been a 50% reduction in the amount of sodium current that the cell can generate. So this is something that we published a number of years ago, and we have continued with other papers on the same tenor. But really, this question kept coming up. The sodium current now, I hope I can convince you, is functionally coupled to proteins that belong to the mechanical junction. It is not just isolated silos of molecules, the desmosomal molecules over here and the sodium channel over here. They are interacting with each other. But are they physically interacting? Are they in contact with each other? Well, we decided to take an approach that really came from neurosciences and for what we know of the organization of the node of Ranvier. As you very well know, sodium channels in myelinated neurons localize at the node of Ranvier. So in the area where there is no myelin, that is where the sodium channels are going to come together and cluster. And they are going to cluster together with proteins that are going to be making mechanical coupling either to the extracellular matrix or to the other cell. So this could be also in the heart, where mechanical junction proteins and sodium channels are clustering together. But whereas you can see this with regular microscopy, because the node of Ranvier is this big, in the heart this would be very, very small and below the limits of resolution of conventional microscopy. So the question that we posed to this great colleague of ours, Eli Rothenberg, is, are there mini nodes of Ranvier at the intercalated disc? So the collaboration with Eli that brought us into the field of what we call visual proteomics, and in this particular case of STORM, has been really extremely productive. For those of you that do microscopy, this is his first setup. And of course, there is nothing coming out through the eyepieces of the microscope. But this was a picture taken by the PR people at NYU. It was going to be about microscopy, so the doctor had to wear a lab coat and look under the microscope. But he knows better. There is nothing there is no light coming out there. The work has been done by these two great postdocs in my lab, Esperanza Guyot-Pascual and Sandra Leo Macias, and a lot of the analysis of the data by a collaboration with a great bioinformatics guy, David Fenyu, and Sarah Kagan. So we want to know whether the sodium channel is associated with mechanical junction proteins. So first, we needed to choose the goalpost of the mechanical junction, and for that we chose N-cadherin. We also want to know where the sodium channel is at the cell membrane. We don't want to know the sodium channel that is just below the membrane or that is on its way to participating in membrane biology. We want to know the sodium channel at the membrane. So we had two problems. We had to solve the problem of where exactly is the intercalated disc membrane, and that's an EM problem. And we want to know how is the sodium channel organized, and that's a fluorescence microscopy problem. So we needed to combine the two techniques into what is called correlative super-resolution fluorescence microscopy, electron microscopy. And the technical details are complex. We'd be happy to share them with all of you. Bottom line is, this is an EM image of the intercalated disc. We have put some gold beads to be used as non-biased fiduciary markers, so you can see them in the EM image. We take the same sample into the super-resolution microscope, and we can then see the fluorescence that is emitted by those gold beads, and then line up the two images with one another, and then see where does our signal for N-cadherin fall. So here I have just traced the intercalated disc to make it easier, and you can see that N-cadherin, as expected, is falling right on the cell membrane of the intercalated disc. So okay, so we have a method. We know where the membrane is, and we know where N-cadherin is. In relation to N-cadherin, where is NaV1.5? And in relation to N-cadherin, NaV1.5, about 50-60% of the times,
is associated with NCAD hearing. Green is NAV 1.5, purple is NCAD hearing. You can see the intercalated disc there, and you can see that the two of them are colocalizing, forming this, what we call adhesion excitability node, or we call it in the lab, mini node of Ranvier. We used average particle analysis to try to get the average mini node of Ranvier, and what you see here is the average NAV 1.5 cluster. This is the average NCAD hearing cluster, and this is the average complex. And you see it better in this image over here. And in this image, you can see the similarity between this cluster of an adhesion molecule and an excitability molecule, so similar to an image that you can get from a node or from a node of Ranvier. All right, so this is happening in the tissue. But this is a 2D thin section of tissue. So is this really the way things are happening in 3D? So we implemented super resolution microscopy in three dimensions. This is using the astigmatic technique. There are other variations of how to do super resolution 3D. Here you have an isolated cardiac myocyte. This is the end of the cell. Purple is NCAD hearing. Green, again, is NAV 1.5. Indeed, there is NAV 1.5 inside the cell as well. But we are going to focus only in the cell end. And here, you can see that we are moving in Z. So these are different sections in Z resolved at 20 nanometers to localize then the three-dimensional element that will be at the cell end. And of course, if we have a three-dimensional object, we can then now rotate it so we can see it from different angles. And here you can, of course, only concentrate on the cell end. And you can see in three dimensions that there are these same nodes of NCAD hearing and NAV 1.5 together. So of the adhesion molecule and the excitation molecule together. All right, so we have these mini nodes. So how do these dimensions match? How do they fall into the big picture of the whole entire intercalated disc? For that, we went to something called focused ion beam scanning electron microscopy. What I am showing here, what is moving is not moving in time, is moving in Z's. So basically, the idea was to reconstruct an entire intercalated disc at EM resolution. And that is the intercalated disc in here. You can see it going between one cell and the other and different planes. So now that you have the entire 3D object, you can use segmentation analysis to take one line at a time. And as you are taking it one line at a time, you then reconstruct the entire three-dimensional object. And this is, for what I know, the first nanometer resolution structure of an intercalated disc. You can see all of these protrusions that, when you look at things in 2D, are very apparent how it is going in a zigzagging manner. So in this entire object, how big is one of our adhesion excitability nodes? Well, it is about that big. It takes about the tip of one of these little finger projections. Now, we know the average cluster is this big. There are atomic models of a bacterial sodium channel, so we know the dimensions of one single sodium channel. And we know in the node of Ranvier how spaced they are between each other. So we put those elements together, and we put all of our sodium channels inside one of these clusters, and the answer is the average cluster of sodium channels at the intercalated disc has about 40 channels. Now, we know how spaced they are at the intercalated disc from the super resolution data, and if we then put them 40 channels at a time, spaced as we know, and we calculated from our data how much current would these channels generate, we came up with the same order of magnitude of current that we have measured using conventional electrophysiological techniques. In other words, these structures represent the functional unit or at least a part of the functional unit that generates sodium current at the intercalated disc. Yes?
So you might be showing this, so just blow by me here, but when you showed us the first picture on the end, we saw that sort of maybe you said 50% or 60% of the associated channels with the structures. Is there some pattern of those within a given area in terms of which ones have the channels associated with them and which don't in a two-dimensional nature?
Well, so what I can tell you is that we have used this technique in addition to what you see here, where you can just patch on a cell-attached mode in a specific region of the cell. It's called scanning patch clamp. Comes from SICM, scanning ion conductance microscopy. And the recordings that we get indicate that that's about how many channels there are as well. But whether the other thing that I can tell you is that the clusters that are not at the membrane seem to be smaller. So I think that they insert in the membrane, they get to a minimal dimension, and those are the ones that develop current. I don't know if I'm answering your question.
Well, I just wonder if there's kind of a spatial pattern to those that have the clusters of sodium channels associated with them.
You mean the N-cadherin clusters?
Yeah.
Is there a spatial pattern? Yes, there is a spatial pattern. I don't have it here, but if you see this, so the cadherins, the cadherin molecule would be at each one of these peaks or valleys if you're looking on the other side. And these peaks have a periodicity. They are about, a distribution of frequencies, and they are around 200 nanometers apart from each other. So there is
pretty
evenly distributed, yeah. Okay, so the bottom line at this point is that there are not mechanical junctions, and then over here there are gap junctions, and then over here there are sodium channels. What we have is not three isolated silos of molecules, but a protein interacting network, where molecules that classically are defined as belonging to one type or to the other interact with each other and together bring about electrical coupling, cell adhesion, and cell excitability. And we have named this molecular complex the connexome. But that's just a name that came out of a Friday afternoon beer. So if you have a better name, I'm not offended. I will go through this quickly so that I have time to present some of the new data. But all right, so what I have told you is that mutations in plakophilin 2 can cause arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy and affect the sodium channel. And I have shown you that the sodium channels and the mechanical junctions are together. So there are two questions that come from that. I will address one and will just tell you the answer of the other one. One that I will just tell you the answer is, well, then are there mutations in the sodium channel that can cause cardiomyopathies? The answer is yes. We have identified several cases of arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy, this disease of the desmosome, where actually the mutation is in the gene coding for NaV1.5 for the sodium channel. And eliminating the sodium channel affects cell-cell adhesion. The other question is, if plakophilin 2 is so linked to NaV1.5, are there diseases classically associated with NaV1.5 that actually result from mutations in plakophilin 2? The classical loss of function disease that relates to mutations in NaV1.5 is called Brugada syndrome. So we looked at 200 cases of Brugada syndrome where no gene had been identified. And we actually found 5 cases in which there was a mutation in plakophilin 2. So this, for those of you that know electrocardiogram, is the typical signature of a Brugada syndrome. It's an ST segment elevation, particularly in the high precordial leads, and with no ischemic or any other cardiac event. And in these five cases, we identified mutations in Placophyllin 2. In one of them, there was a very good co-segregation with members of the family. We used an expression system to see whether that mutation in Placophyllin 2 would change the sodium current, and indeed, we observed that it does. All five of the mutations in Placophyllin 2 brought about a reduction in the magnitude of the sodium current. This is a common polymorphism in Placophyllin 2, and when we tested that polymorphism, we saw it not to be different from the control. So the answer is yes, there are these mutations in Placophyllin 2 that can give you the phenotype of Brugada syndrome, of the disease associated with the sodium channel. We took iPSs just to sort of corroborate this from a patient that had a recessive mutations in Placophyllin 2. So these are cells from a patient that does not put Placophyllin 2 in the cell membrane. We looked at the sodium current amplitude in cells from that patient. And if we then expressed Placophyllin 2 in these cells, sodium current went up, like this. And if, on the other hand, we used one of our mutations of Placophyllin 2, the sodium current did not go up. All right, so up to this point, I am going to conclude that Brugada syndrome may associate with Placophyllin 2 mutations that cause an undetectable structural disease and a sodium current deficit. So two diseases that have been classified generally by belonging to two different genes actually are not. They can cross talk. So Placophyllin 2 is not a single function protein. We have talked about Placophyllin 2 having to do with cell adhesion. We have talked about Placophyllin 2 having to do with the sodium channel. I did not discuss this, but we have found it to be associated with the gap junctions as well. So studies from other laboratories, though, have indicated that Placophyllin 2, and in general the desmosome, is important for the control of transcription. This is something that, if you work in the cancer field, will not surprise you, because you have read and studied about contact inhibition of cell growth. When cells come into contact and form a mechanical junction, that, mediated by beta-catenin, interrupts the process of cell division. Now, the heart cells, after development, do not divide. But there are things that a frustrated division of a cell still has the molecular machinery for. And one of them is, if you lose the cell-cell contact, you lose the integrity of the mechanical junction, you send signal to the nucleus in the heart cell that cannot start cell division, but that will alter the transcription program of the cell. And one of the things that happens is that it starts expressing genes that have to do with fibrosis. But we ask the question, are these changes in transcription having any role in the mechanism of cardiac arrhythmias in these hearts? So to answer this question, and here I'm showing you our most recent data, is with this mouse that we generated. This is a conditional cardiac-specific knockout of Placophyllin 2 that is going to be activated by the injection of tamoxifen. So these mice that are FLOX-FLOX Cre positive under the alpha-myosin heavy chain, when they develop in the absence of tamoxifen, they behave like any normal happy mouse. When we inject them with tamoxifen, which we do when they are about 3 months of age, then they are going to start losing the expression of Placophyllin 2. So we're going to be able to look in only in cardiac myocytes and in the adult heart what the role of Placophyllin 2 is in the adult heart by knocking it out and following the time course of whatever happens after that injection. Well, the first thing that happens is that they will die. But they will die after about 28 days. Up to 28 days, they all survive. And then we see in this Kaplan-Meier curve that they die, and we had one mouse that survived to day 50, and that is the longest that have survived. But between day 0 and day 28, they are all alive. We do echocardiograms on the mice, and I am going to present you just selected data sets of what is a very extensive study. But the important point is, I want you to follow this, the days post-tamoxifen injection. So day 0 is the day we injected tamoxifen, and up to day 21, there is only a slight reduction in the left ventricular ejection fraction. So these mice are not in failure. They have normal, their mechanical function is still perfectly compatible with normal life. This would be what you would call a concealed stage of the disease in a human. They are not showing any sign of disease. Now, when we look at these mice at day 35, when already some of them have died, we found a really clear biventricular dilated cardiomyopathy. There is extensive fibrosis in both ventricles. Interestingly, like in the case of the humans, the septum is pretty much spared. There is some fibrosis, but even at this stage, which in the case of a human would be a stage in which would need a cardiac transplant, the septum is not very much involved. If we look at them at 14 days after injection, the heart looks perfectly normal. Both the right and the left ventricle are showing structural integrity. And if we look at day 21, then is something very interesting. You can see that in this particular case, the right ventricle is already fibrotic, but the left ventricle is not. So this is a cardiomyopathy of right ventricular predominance. We have knocked out plakophilin 2 in the entire heart, not only in the right ventricle. As the patients, as the humans, they have a mutation in plakophilin 2 in the entire genome. But the disease appears first in the right ventricle, which tells us, and this is a controversy in the field, but tells us that there are physiological reasons for the right ventricular predominance rather than molecular or developmental reasons for it. So we can quantify the fibrosis, and you can see here at day 14, the right, which is the red, and the left have very little fibrosis, very little collagen, sorry, we're quantifying collagen. At day 21, we have the right ventricle already showing quite a bit of collagen, the left ventricle showing only small amounts, and they, of course, then the left ventricle also shows collagen. So we picked this day 21, as the day in which we're going to do some additional functional studies, because it looks to be that time in at which that boy of 16-year-old that I presented at the beginning, that's where he was. Had a right cardiomyopathy of right ventricular predominance in a concealed stage of the disease. So are these animals arrhythmogenic at this point? When we looked at their EKGs on their basal conditions, we didn't see anything. There were no arrhythmias, either at day 14 or at day 21. There were no arrhythmias. But when we put isoproterenol in them, and I should tell you that we did this as a surrogate to, these are catecholaminergic arrhythmias. You know, I was telling you of the boy that died during exercise. So as a surrogate of a catecholaminergic stimulus, then we get a lot of arrhythmias. These are the average premature ventricular contractions in a 20-minute period. And you can see there are 620 PVCs during that period in about 60% of the cases that we studied. Now, interestingly, at day 16, when there are no PVCs with isoproterenol other than a few, in half of the cases, though, they switched very quickly to polymorphic ventricular tachycardia, ventricular fibrillation, and sudden death. So right in that stage in which the heart is transitioning from normal to cardiomyopathic, is the only window of vulnerability that we have found for sudden death. And that is also in the case of the humans. The patients that have a well-settled ARVC with loss of mechanical function have lots of monomorphic VT, but they do not present polymorphic VT, and they don't die suddenly. It is the young one in the concealed stage, the one that develops the arrhythmogenic event, the lethal arrhythmogenic events. Okay, so this is a great model to do some molecular stuff. And what we decided to do was to do RNA-seq. In other words, we want to take the entire spectrum of the transcript and see what's going on. And what we did was we started, as you know, these techniques with 45,000 genes, actually transcripts, not genes. And we found 500 of them were downregulated. And this is a heat map just to show you that there was very good consistency between animals inside the group. We then did the functional analysis of the genes. And fortunately, the most significant downregulated network was ARVC. That was good for us because that was the disease that we thought we were modeling. Dilated cardiomyopathy hit high. But calcium signaling came also as a very high hit. The eighth most important functional network affected was the regulation of intracellular calcium. That came to us as a surprise, but as a very welcome surprise, because it tells us that in the whole transcriptional change that occurs after the loss of plakophilin 2, there is a network of genes that are essential for maintaining the cardiac rhythm that transcriptionally are being downregulated and therefore could be part of the mechanism of sudden death in these patients. So we looked more carefully at those, and this is a volcano plot. Basically, we are just looking at what are the entire panorama of the genes that are affected. And what we found is anchorin B, the calcium channel, calsequestrin, and ryanodine and triadin are all significantly downregulated after we lose plakophilin 2. If we do functional analysis, we observe that indeed calcium transients are of a larger magnitude, longer duration. We have done a lot of work with this to try to figure out what is going on, and I'm just going to give you the punchlines instead of taking you through all of the pains that we went through to try to understand what was happening. Basically, what is happening is that there is an increase in the easy coupling gain. In other words, the regulation of intracellular calcium involves, as you probably know, something called the dyad. You have the T-tubule in the heart, which is where the calcium channel is going to be, and in front of it is the junctional sarcoplasmic reticulum, which is where there is a lot of calcium stored. When the calcium enters through the calcium channel, it's going to hit the ryanodine receptor, and that is going to make the ryanodine receptor open, which will allow calcium to be extruded from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. This calcium will go and find the actin myosin molecules to then form the bridges that are necessary for the development of contraction. So what we found is that because of these changes in the abundance of the transcripts, there is an increase in the gain of that system. In other words, for the same amount of calcium current, we get more release of intracellular calcium. The control of intracellular calcium in the cell is very important for arrhythmogenesis. If the calcium is too high, it causes other changes in the cell membrane that lead to arrhythmias. And so what we have found is that there is an increase in the gain. Even though the calcium current is smaller, the amplitude of the calcium transient is larger in the absence of plakophilin 2. We did, with Natalia Trajanova, some mathematical simulations to show that indeed just those molecular events can explain the increasing gain. And indeed, there are, and I will not go into the detail, but these type of calcium transients are indicative of arrhythmogenesis in these cells. Okay, so mice are a great system to study the effects of drugs. And we define drug the same way that Otto Loewi did. And as you probably know, this is the man that discovered acetylcholine in the 1930s, a very famous pharmacologist, won the Nobel Prize. And he said this: a drug is a substance that, when injected into an animal, produces a paper. And so with that definition, we decided to look at some drug that would help the paper. And we chose flecainide. Flecainide is a very interesting drug because it has been shown, and it is used clinically, to block the ryanodine receptor channel in cases of a disease called CPVT, or catecholaminergic polymorphic ventricular tachycardia. So here we go again. A change in plakophilin 2, which is supposed to be a desmosomal molecule that has to do with adhesion and only responsible for some cases of ARVC, is actually giving us a phenotype that reproduces another inheritable arrhythmia disease called CPVT. And most importantly, here we have a drug that can be used in patients, flecainide, that is being used in patients with CPVT successfully, that could be used in patients with ARVC to prevent their arrhythmic events. So, a final question. So, all right, I have a patient with exercise-induced polymorphic ventricular tachycardia, normal QT, and no structural disease. It's a young patient, and I did the entire panel for CPVT. Could it be ARVC without the cardiomyopathy? So we looked into both the cardiovascular genetics clinic in NYU, as well as collaboration with the cardiovascular genetics program at the Mayo with Mike Ackerman. And we found several cases. I will show you just this one. Several cases of CPVT gene negative that then we looked, and they had mutations in plakophilin 2. Here's one case. A 13-year-old girl in good health, family history negative for sudden cardiac death, in March of 2013 has a prolonged syncopal episode while playing lacrosse, decorticate posturing, loss of bladder control, the whole gamish. Self-resolved without CPR. Clinical evaluation, ECG with an anterior abnormal precordial repolarization, but it is still a 13-year-old, so it may have T waves that are negative because it's still a 13-year-old. Stress test, exercise-induced PVC, prompting test interruption, echo within normal limits, cardiac MRI, normal RV, and LV dimensions. Is given beta blockers, exercise restriction. Of course, she's a teenager, so she's not going to do what the doctor tells her. She goes ahead and continues exercising. December of 2013, presyncopal episode, playing sports, vision blur, spontaneous resolution. February, another syncopal episode, chest pounding rapidly, loss of bladder control, CPR, and is resolved in 1 minute. Repeated evaluation, normal echo, normal MRI, frequent PVCs at effort. May 2014, genetic testing. We went ahead and then did the panel for ARVC, and the genetic testing gives us a very severe plakophilin 2 mutation, a truncation of the plakophilin 2 at amino acid 589, which is definitely a disease-causing mutation. So, follow-up, July 2014, she's given an ICD. January 2015, there is an appropriate shock and ventricular fibrillation. Then she goes for epicardial ablation. She is successfully ablated and has been arrhythmia-free. It remains free of evidence of structural disease. So by task force criteria, this patient has arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, except she does not have right ventricular cardiomyopathy, only the arrhythmogenic case. So what I have tried to show you is summarized in this slide. So there are at least four functions that can be ascribed to plakophilin 2. It's involved in cell adhesion, it's involved in transcription, in the sodium channel complex, and in gap junctions. As such, it is involved in four fundamental functions of the cell: metabolic, mechanical function, and cell integrity, control of intracellular calcium, that's the data that I just showed you, the control of the sodium current and electrical coupling. So if things go wrong with Plakophilin 2, then you can have impaired contractility and increased cell death. But you can also have electrical events, including triggered activity. Importantly, all of these events do not have to happen in parallel, or not all of them. You can go down one path without going down another. And so, if you go down this path, you will end up with triggered activity, arrhythmias, and sudden cardiac death. If you go down this path, you will end up with a dilated cardiomyopathy and reparative fibrosis. If you only went down on this path, you will think that your patient has CPVT. If you went down this path, you would end up thinking that the patient has Brugada syndrome. If you go down this path and you don't have the typical cardiomyopathy, you may think that the patient has dilated cardiomyopathy. All of this together constitutes the overall syndrome of arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. But there is no one gene, one disease. This is only an example of many others that are now in the field of inheritable arrhythmias, where we really have to rethink the idea that inheritable arrhythmias can be defined as Mendelian diseases. And with this, I will stop you, and thank you very much for your attention.
Any question time? James. Yes.
Chris, I'm Mario. So I actually got two quick questions. So first of all, for the Plakophilin transcriptional stuff, which is really, really cool, would the same thing happen if you mess with another protein in the desmosome, would you speculate? Or is it specific?
I will speculate, yes, but it has to be in the desmosome set. So I think the same would happen if we did placoglobin, and I think the same would happen if we do desmoplakin. The time course is going to be different, of course, but in terms of the transcriptome, I think that they are going to be similar in many ways.
Okay, my second question was just on the calcium stuff. So basically, there's more calcium channels on the cardiomyocyte than those in close opposition to the reanimator. I always imagine those guys are involved in like second messenger going into their signal transduction cascade. Do you think that's playing a role in what you're seeing? And I know it's difficult to dissect that.
Yeah, it is very difficult. And whether those are the ones involved in transcription, you're saying. That's a very cool hypothesis that I have no answer for. What I can tell you is that doing scanning patch clamp, we find that there is a reduction in the calcium channels at the T-tubules, but not at the crest. But whether the ones that are involved with the caveolin are the ones that are doing the transcriptional part, it's a great idea.
David?
One of the sort of classic features of ARVC is not only fibrosis, but actually fatty infiltration, particularly in the right ventricle. And I noticed on your transcription profile that there was an adipocyte cytokine that was, I believe, turned on.
They are in the downregulated and also in the upregulated. They are both.
Okay, so the question is there some specific signal sent to recruit fat cells into the heart, or how do you explain that? Because it's unusual, and it's actually used in the diagnosis to detect the fatty infiltrate in the right ventricle on the MRI. Is there a signal to recruit these there, or is that an explanation or thought about that?
Yeah. So there are several parts to answer your question. One is that actually in the 2010 task force criteria, they removed adiposes from the diagnosis. So it is fibrosis with or without adiposes. And that is because, as you very well know, there are cases of ARVC that don't have the fat deposits, and there are cases of fatty hearts that don't have ARVC. But indeed, it is common to have this fatty deposit in the right ventricle. Some people, and there is no mouse model, and that applies to ours, that has the fat deposits. And that, we think, is just because a matter of time. The fat takes much longer to settle than just collagen. But with that being said, there has been work on the fact that some of the transcription factors that get altered by the loss of desmosomal integrity are pro-fibrotic and pro-adiposic. So there is a school of thinking that says that the cardiac myocytes are becoming adipocytes. I don't subscribe to that idea. I don't think that a myocyte can turn into an adipocyte. My thought is that actually these adipocytes are the result of epicardial mesenchymal transformation from cells in the epicardium that normally are the progenitors of fibroblasts that then go into the adipocyte lineage. But we are actually in the process of testing that hypothesis.
Yeah, and there's some support from work in skin on that as well. There was a paper came out in Nature just this week talking about how cells of mesenchymal lineage that could give rise to myofibroblasts are able to undergo transdifferentiation into adipocytes. So, Mike.
I'm sure this right. So the smaller transmembrane calcium currents, the presumably voltage-gated delta calcium channels, mm-hmm. gave rise to a larger ranitidine calcium signal, mm-hmm. so this gain in the coupling. So if you were to treat a patient with that, with a typical calcium channel blocker, and further reduce the transmembrane current, is there some sort of linear relationship on what that gain is in the knockout? So can you predict what that would do in terms of the calcium signal versus interfering with the ranitidine receptor?
Yeah, so using a calcium channel blocker would, of course, decrease the calcium current. I am going to assume that there would be a proportionate decrease in the amount of ranitidine being released with the increased gain, then meaning that there is now normal.
But is that predictable? Is it linear? Is that relationship known? That's what I was getting at.
So mathematical simulations would predict that it is linear, but whether in biology that happens or not, I don't think that has been studied. Okay. Or at least, I don't know the answer.
If patients like that might be initially given calcium channel blockers, and what happens if the predictable decrease is satisfactory, or untoward events happen possibly,
yeah.
by not knowing what that relationship is?
I don't know. That's an interesting question. I don't think that calcium channel blockers have worked for these patients. I know that they don't work. Whereas the flecainide, after our work and work of others, people have started to use it with some success.
All right, we'll go 1, 2, 3. Go, Si.
Fantastic talk, Mario.
Thank you.
Two questions for you. One on the basic science end of things. It's known that the sodium channels exist as heterotremers with beta subunits, and some of those are both adhesion molecules and can heterologously interact with other adhesion molecules, like adherin. So when you see this association between sodium channels and adhesion proteins, is it 1.5 directly, or is there beta involvement? And the other question I have is on the sort of more clinical end of things. You're showing us now that the model should be more of one gene, many diseases. And Connie Pizzina's work on Brugada syndrome suggests that it's also many genes, one disease, because one single mutation doesn't always produce Brugada phenotypes. So when and how do you use genetic testing with a patient?
So that was a third question.
Sorry. You know, I got emotional. let me take another sip. So the work of Connie and the work of others is showing that there is this multiplicity of effects. Sorry. I think that Connie and I would agree, I know that we do agree, that there are what you call complex syndromes. And it is going in both directions. So you can have Brugada syndrome because of PKP2 mutations, right? I showed you. And so you can have one clinical disease that is the result of multiple genes. Now, to make it even more complicated, I really don't think that any of these diseases are monogenic. And that is why they are so low penetrance. ARVC has a penetrance of 50-60% in the family. So when do you use genetic testing? You use genetic testing because it is one tool. You don't use genetic testing because that is the diagnosis. That's my personal opinion. To do genetic testing just, you know, on the blind creates an enormous amount of confusion for the families. Keep in mind that in these diseases, the only thing that really works is to take the patient out of exercise. Many of them are actually athletes. So this happens all the time in the clinic, right? You get the mother that comes with a 13, 14-year-old and tells you the tragic loss of her older son was playing frisbee in the campus in college. All of a sudden, he dropped dead. Her question is, first, what happened to my son? And second, is this one next? That is a very difficult question. Risk stratification in inherited arrhythmias is a major area of major importance. Genetic testing can create a lot of confusion. If you do the genetic testing in the 14-year-old and you find a variant of unknown significance in plakophilin 2, are you going to leave that kid without exercise, without any clinical signs, without anything other, without no familial co-segregation, with nothing? No. You monitor them, you keep a very close eye. So one of the things actually that we do in the lab now is to use visual proteomics in IPS-derived cardiac myocytes to try to develop predictors that don't depend on the genetic information but on the proteomic information. Your first question, of course, these are major macromolecular complexes. The beta subunit, I am sure, is a part of it. The work that you guys have done is beautiful to show also the localization in the perinexus. And these complexes in different regions are probably carrying different partners. We do know that for the sodium channel that is inside the cell, has different partners. And if you have changes in those partners, you develop a different disease, right? A dystrophinopathy. So,
Carissa?
Yeah, going back to your 3D reconstruction of the intercalated disc, I think you said that the mini nodes tend to be focused at the peaks and valleys. So are there any other proteins that you've seen that are localized to those regions? And what is the functional role of it being organized?
Right, so it associates with the answer to and the question of Psi. So let me take a step back. When you do EM of the intercalated disc, you find adherence junctions mostly at the peak of those hills. Because we have the localization within cadherin at the EM level, we also see it mostly in those peaks. So that is where we think the complex is going to be. But we don't have a 3D reconstruction of EM with the super resolution to really validate that. Indeed, we did only two molecules because it's already complicated enough. But there are techniques to then, from those two that we have, expand the vision of the whole complex. And we're heading in that direction.
Okay.
Just
two easy questions. Why did you decide to, in your Fox device, inject the Fox device that? To study a young adult animal, because that is the age for the patients. Usually they are young adults when they have the case that I show, a 16-year-old, is on the early spectrum of the events of the syncope. They are mostly in their mid-20s.
Okay, and in your figure that was comparing the two ventricles, which collagens do you look at in the heart?
Oh, that is just trichrome staining. So I don't know what collagen is being produced. That's a very important question. Probably there's a different collagen expressed, but that's just trichrome, so it's just staining any collagen.
I wonder if the dominance of the right ventricle
So that's the dominance of the right ventricle is an interesting question in this model because, as I say, there is no development. I mean, many of the hypotheses that have to do with the right ventricular predominance come from developmental biology. There is no developmental biology here. This is an adult animal. Some of the hypotheses have to do with cells of the second heart field. Second heart field is history at the point in which we're studying these animals. And they still have this right ventricular predominance. So I think that it is a balance between the hemodynamic load and the mechanical efficiency of the right ventricle under conditions of either exercise or isoproterenol that is giving the right ventricular predominance.
Did you? Yeah.
Yeah.
One last quick question, John.
Yeah. Mario, a fantastic talk.
Thanks.
So I noticed in your RNA-seq data, the number two most prominent was vascular smooth muscle, so that just got me as the vascular biology person here. Curious about that, and you just actually mentioned it, the hemodynamic load. I was wondering, so we always had a tough time in developmental settings decoupling a defect that could be actually affecting the heart that affects the hemodynamics in the vessels, that it maybe it's secondary to a heart defect. I was wondering here if you're actually, if you've got a defect in the vascular smooth muscle, inability to relax or constrict, I can't remember which, if it's loading the heart inappropriately and sort of exacerbating your...
So in this case, since we are knocking out only in the myocytes...
So is that myosin chain 7?
Alpha myosin is 6.
6, okay.
It starts in the myocyte. Mm-hmm. Now, mind you, these are RNA-seq data from whole heart. So some of the differences could be because of the loss of blood microcirculation integrity in to a certain extent. But, as you very well know, RNA-seq gives you such an enormous amount of data, you have to then pick a little piece and then dissect
it. Consistent with that those hits that makes sense. That one just caught my eye. You showed it. Like you said, you have so much data, but you picked it, and it's one of the top.
Yeah, that's one of the top.
That came out, so it's just curious to me.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thanks so much, Mario.
Thank you very much.
We got you on a fairly short chain, I think. So lunch with the
students.
Great
talk. Yeah, thank you for coming out, Mario.
Thank you very much.
Very informative. Appreciate it.